Hello, and welcome to another episode of Purlfect Pairings. My name is Gayanne, she, her.
And my name's Nicole, and my pronouns are she and her. And today we're coming to you from a very different location. You can see in the background, we are not in our usual spot. So We're coming to you from Tarndwarncoort, which is a farming property near Colac in southern Victoria. And today I would like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land, which are the Gulidjan people in this area. And we would like to pay our respects to elders past and present, and particularly welcome any Indigenous people that might be watching us today. We'd also like to acknowledge the often fraught relationship between farming and Indigenous land rights, and to also acknowledge the contribution of Indigenous people to the fibre industry over millennia. So we need to start off with a little bit of admin. Firstly, thank you for watching. Thank you for being here. If you enjoy our episodes, please like the post, please give it a thumbs up. Please subscribe to our channel because that helps with the algorithms and getting it in front of more faces. And please share with your fibre and, well, knitting fibre loving friends. Also, please keep up the comments.
We've had a lot of encouragement, and that just makes it easier for us to get motivated to produce this content. It's just, it's really lovely to see.
It's not that it needs much motivation. We're pretty excited about doing it. But no, we love comments, and we would love to hear from you if there's something that you would like to see. So we are trying to bring you a really good representation of the Australian fibre industry, and we're big knitters as well, so quite a lot of good knitting content, lots of new ideas for projects and that sort of thing. So today we are in this new setting because we have an interview that we are thrilled to have organised. As I mentioned earlier, we're at Tarndwarncoort, which is a sheep farm in southern Victoria in Australia, a particularly well-known sheep farm, and we'll hear a bit more about that in the interview.
Sorry, I'm just about like jumping out of my seat. It was so fun.
Yeah, super fun. So I'm not going to delay this any longer. Let's cut straight to our chat with Tom Dennis from Tarndwarncoort, or as it's locally known, Tarndie.
An exciting day because I am sitting here with the none other than Tom Dennis, who is like, I don't know, Australian farming royalty. This is very Australian with the flies.
It is, yeah, maximum.
We are here at Tarndie. A lot of local people will know this wool from various shops or yarn markets that you go to. I think that's where I learned about you the first time.
Yes.
So we're here for an interview. How are you?
Great, hot.
It is.
Enjoying this summer weather. But
it is.
Yeah. Hey, what an introduction. I think we might be overstating it a little bit. But you know, thanks very much for it. I think on that front, like, I am just the the current custodian generation person in charge of it at the moment. That there's a lot of, you know, people before me that have been in this place, and so yeah, I certainly defer to them when you talk about those sorts of words. It's not my thing. I'm just the current guy.
There is a lot of history here. Can you tell me a bit about the history of the farm and like this? We're sitting on the porch of the farmstead here with this beautiful bluestone wall behind us. So
yeah.
Can you tell us about the history of the place?
Yeah, look, there is plenty to bore you with, that's for sure. But if we kind of put it into a nutshell, I guess kind of looking at the house is one easy way to kind of contextualize the history. But this house that we're sitting in front of is what they call wool check architecture, which kind of tells you that wool's been around for a long time in this place. In fact, since 1840, when my sort of forebears set out to go wool farming in Australia, and each generation sort of built a little bit of this house, and that sort of reflects the prosperity of the time and what materials and stuff around. But they call it wool check architecture because that's what funded it, really, was the development of the wool. And so right behind us is the 1878 bit, when the price of wool was high, and because of war in Russia. This is the boring thing that happens when we start talking.
It's not boring at all, because I feel like there's a quite parallels to now.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
like certain
exactly.
cost of living and pressures that we have in Australia currently.
And you know what, the flooring in here is probably a story that a lot of people will resonate with, because it's Baltic pine flooring in this building here. And the reason why, and a lot of places around, particularly around Melbourne ports, that sort of area, is because
mm-hmm.
wool was shipped to the Russian war, so it was the Crimean War.
Mm-hmm.
And because they wanted wool for blankets and new soldier uniforms and these sorts of things, so they're shipping into Odessa, and then those
mm-hmm.
ships were being returned. They couldn't come back empty, so they brought back Baltic pine.
Because of the weight.
The weight. They sit on the bottom of the ship, and then they got back into port, like into Melbourne, so they get more wool, offloaded all the logs. Local sawmill has chopped them up into planks, and so Baltic pine flooring in the inner suburbs is like this link because of the wool trade.
That's really super interesting. No, really.
We can go down.
I think it's fascinating.
Thank you, guys.
So
that's it. That's the only story that we've got to say about the history of this place.
So Baltic
pine flooring. But yeah, look, there is lots that we kind of can go down, but the crux of the history of this place is about wool growing. It just so happened that we sort of stuck at it as a family, and each generation has continued this wool growing journey.
How many generations?
So I'm number six here, which is kind of, you know, unusual in that most family businesses have this pattern. It could be farming, it could be watchmaking, it could be whatever it is. Goes in this sort of cycle of three. So
mm-hmm.
like founder, sort of the guy that maybe goes to excess, and the poor person that sort of has to wrap it up, sell it, or
mop it up.
Yeah,
yeah. And is it always been just sheep here, or?
No. So it's, sheep has been the mainstay though. So it's had a like this interesting wave of adaptation, experimentation. Apples were really early in the piece, which then triggered a whole cider house sort of thing, making local ciders. Local mm-hmm. ciders. I don't think they called it local ciders. No, it was just cider.
That would be craft.
Yeah,
right?
craft
cider.
Yeah. And then they had turkeys for a while, lots of cattle cropping. And a lot of these things kind of fit in around the wool growing schedule anyway. So. There's a lot of cropping that fits with wool growing, because you want the sheep to go in after the wheat, for example, has been harvested and graze the stubble.
Yep.
So sheep and wool growing fit in quite well to a lot of other farming systems. So yeah, lots of other things, but the wool has been the focus and the mainstay.
So your family then has been entrenched in farming, but I know that you have worked in both Asia and Africa. What did you do while you were abroad, and then what brought you back?
That's right. Growing up, it was a matter of like, no way on earth am I going to be a farmer. That's not for me. And partly that's because of the ebb and flow of farming, where it's often quite low income. And so growing up in the 90s, it was a low income era for a lot of wool growers. And so looking at it, they go, well, why would I do that? That looks horrid. Like mum and dad are flogging themselves to, we're not going on holidays. We're not doing anything fun.
It's a lot of work.
It's a lot of work, and there doesn't seem to be much, you know, gain for it. So I don't think I would be alone in thinking that farming wasn't for me with that sort of background in the 1990s. I'm happy to say that at the minute, it seems pretty cool to be in farming, actually. Like my 16-year-old nephew lives with us quite often, and he's 16 years old, and you know the world's available to him, and he just wants to be involved in farming and going up and down paddocks in tractors. Like that's the coolest thing you could do. So I think there's his ebb and flow. So farming was never something that I really wanted to get into, really. So I thought, right, I'm gonna do other things.
Okay, what did you do?
So the big wide world was kind of exciting to me, and so it was really about how to go and explore it. But kind of coincidentally, in that 90s, Japan was pretty big in the wool game. And so we had quite a lot of contact with Japanese wool buyers and just sort of random, I don't know what it was, connections here on this farm. And in fact, we had an NHK film crew staying with us for 2 weeks or something, just to kind of see what is life like in an Australian farm sort of thing. It was really kind of exciting. And so that sort of made me aware of Japan and what, I don't know, learnt language, went and studied there and worked over there for a couple of years in sort of tourism and hospitality events, that mm-hmm. sort of work. Mm-hmm. Which was really cool. But the whole time there, and also myself less so in Africa, my brother, well, one of them still lives there, he's 20 years there working cotton, which is really interesting.
Uh-huh.
And my other brother also worked over there, and his farming practice today is very largely influenced by what he saw in animal behaviour in migration and natural systems of how animals exist in Africa. So Al can tell you more about that at some point, but there's certainly in Africa a bit, but I only worked in hospitality tourism. So we traveled around a lot, and every time I was somewhere, I was thinking, this place, you know, it might be a park bench in Barcelona or something. I was like, this place has got a thing, isn't it? Like, what? And then just sit there and just dissect it. Like, not enjoy the place, but like, okay, so that chair's positioned there, those people, there's a thing there. And the whole time thinking, okay, so this place has got a thing, it feels good. How can I replicate that? How can I bring that to my own sort of family home, in a way? How can we invigorate Tarndwarncoort to be good and lively and a place for people?
Like internalizing that kind of holiday feeling and bringing that home.
I think that's what it was, but also kind of, yeah, just giving purpose to a place, and I think that's sort of been my interest in at Tarndwarncoort, is kind of like, okay, there's the heritage stuff, and there's certainly the wool stuff, but how do you kind of bring it together so that that place has purpose and it's mm-hmm. going to like survive.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Now with your brother in cotton in Africa, do we have a chance of getting a Polwarth cotton blend?
Imagine it. It's organic cotton from Mozambique, and it's sort of a very convoluted sort of setup, but it'd be amazing to tie these little threads together.
In the cards, I reckon. Get on that.
African cotton, Australian wool.
We'd be about it.
All right.
What does a typical day look like for you?
So in reality, I wouldn't say I'm much of a farmer as I am a, you know, property manager. So my days can be pretty boring, I've got to say. It's like, okay, we're going to do cleaning and then washing and la, 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 because we have accommodation here as well as looking after this big old joint.
It is beautiful accommodation. That's where Nicole and I are staying tonight. So we've seen it.
So there's a lot of that. And this old place, the old homestead is on 60 acres, which is not a farm. So my brother runs the farm, brother Al. And he grows the wool, and so his typical day involves sheep but also chickens, and so the purpose of that is that the 3,000 so hens get around the farm, they scratch up the pasture looking for bugs, they fertilize the soil at the same time and mm-hmm. keep the soil in really good condition. So So that's that little tangent there.
It's a bit of regeneration of the...
That's exactly right. And that's because we do have a small farm, and it's about making every speck of that farm work to its fullest capacity. So that's why we need to look after the soil as much as we can. That's why we kind of add a few more layers to our business here with accommodation and events and things that bring it all back to wool, but it's sort of making it more than what it would be if it was just a small, unviable sheep farm.
So Tom, I've read the website and I got a bit of history on that about the first sheep that were here were brought over from England and were Merinos. But now you're most well known for Polwarths. And I, from my background, I know that Clara Parks in her book, The Knitter's Book of Wool, has called a Polwarth an Australian innovation. What can you tell me about that?
Yeah, that's true. And it's true that it's an innovation, but I guess it was sort of born out of necessity where great-great-great-grandfather's 615 Merino flock, which he brought across from Tasmania, were Saxon Merinos, and a sheep of that era, so we're talking 1840, the Merino was a much smaller beast and quite a delicate thing. It's hard to kind of imagine it when you see a Merino today because they've been bred for sort of volume and ability to cut lots of wool off it and have the extra wrinkles and all these sorts of stuff. But previously, a Merino was quite small, and so it was good in hot conditions and dry areas, but where my forebears sort of settled here in the northern parts of the Otway rainforest, it was wetter than it was a merino sheep was best suited to. So
that can really damage their feet, right?
That's right. Yeah, so that's right, if they spend a lot of time with wet feet, they're more susceptible to foot rot, which is a germ in itself, but a delicate hoof is more prone to disease from it. But also, it's about fibre density on the sheep. So if that water is collecting in a fleece, it needs to be able to drain away. Otherwise, if it stays there, it's going to kind of rot and create like a discoloration and eventually rot the fleece. So to avoid that, there sort of needs to be enough separation between fibres that the water can shed. As you probably know, Merino is a very finely wooled animal with lots and lots of fibre follicles poking out of it and very dense. And so therefore that water can't kind of get out. So that was the main thing, I think, was about being adapted to improve the sheep so it could be adapted to a wetter environment.
And that's actually been a problem this year, hasn't it, with the wet spring that we've had?
Yeah, that's the Merino. That's right. I couldn't speak for Merinos because we don't have any here, but certainly it's been a wetter spring. And the concern around that is then, those sort of conditions where it's warm and it's wet at the same time that can then lead to fly strike. And so from a farming point of view, that's like a really tricky thing to find yourself in because you've got to look a lot of care for the sheep and it puts them under strain. So avoiding a situation where you've got lots of moisture in warmth on the animal is to avoid.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The Polwarth breed is a blend that comes from the Merino and also Lincoln. Merino is a nice, soft, short fibred thing like this usually, of about 18 to 20 micron. Lincoln is a very long, staple, lustrous, deep crimp beauty from England in a wet environment. So it's 3/4 Merino, 1/4 Lincoln.
And does that make them a hardier breed than regular Merino?
Yeah, that's right. So it gives them a bit more sturdiness in the wet environment. It allows them to shed that water a lot better. And there's also some less tangible things about mothering and temperament that come from the Lincoln that we enjoy.
How did they land on the Lincoln as the cross?
Yeah, I haven't stopped to think about it a whole lot other than the fact that there were Lincolns in the region for meat. And I think it was an availability thing. It's like, how do we fix this? And so I think there wasn't a great pool of sheep to choose from in the 1800s of Victoria. So I'd say it was probably because of their meat use.
Mm-hmm. Now for Polwarths, are they a wool only breed or are they a dual kind of meat wool breed?
Yeah, well, that's exactly it. So it is a dual purpose breed. And what that means is that it's good for wool and meat. That was certainly the case in the 1950s and earlier when the development of other breeds wasn't as strong, and so there wasn't a clear winner in terms of like we're going to go down the meat path or we're going to go down the wool path, because the price of wool may fall, the price of meat may fall. So a lot of farmers were interested in a way where they could sort of hedge their bets in a way. Since those times, the desire for a dual purpose sheep has lessened because farmers have focused in on either we're just going to go for really fine wool or we're going to really hone in on a very meaty carcass sheep.
Mm-hmm.
So the nature of dual purpose sheep like Polwarth is probably not as relevant today as it was in the past. However, genetic diversity is something that we should be kind of keen to promote and maintain, because mm-hmm. if we all have the one sheep, we're opening ourselves up for market changes or a raft of unforeseen circumstances.
Are you seeing any impacts of climate change?
What could I say to that? So my business is very much focused on talking to the user of our wool. It's not going through 25 middlemen before it ends up in somebody's hands and on their body. Like, we're talking to you as the maker. And so the climate change in that perspective is, okay, well, we know that that person making this is going to know about climate change. They're going to know that it's important to make the decision about what sort of fibres they're going to use, and where do we sit with that. In terms of like impact that we see on the farm from climate change, I don't know that we can specify anything at this point, but it's certainly something that we take into consideration with the farm, but also, you know, is there in the homestead, is, you know, what does climate change look like and how we're going to be ready for that sort of thing. I mean, climate change is one thing, but understanding about emissions and supply chains, all these sorts of things, I think are in that same headspace, aren't they? Mm. And so a lot of our customers are there. And so we want to be as transparent with them about our supply chains so that they can make decisions whether that's good for them or not.
But I can see you've got some wool there. Can you tell me what makes Polwarth
amazing?
Because I'm knitting a shawl with it right now.
Yeah.
I think Nicole is also knitting a shawl with it right now. It's beautiful.
Let me show you what a Polwarth sheep looks like. And so, okay, a Polwarth sheep was bred to be white, but in this sort of generations of adaptation, then my parents decided that they needed to be black and brown and grey and all these other colours. So in the 1970s, Mum and Dad brought these guys into the mix. And so I'm showing you a black and white one because they show some fairly specific markings on a Polwarth that you wouldn't see on a white Polwarth. And so in the lamb there, you can see it's got a white tail. The ewe's got a white, like, down the front bit and the blaze on its nose, top knot and socks. Anyway, so this sheep is around about 22 to 24 micron, and that's probably, and fibre length at about 110 mil, which is probably what makes Polwarth special, in that it's a, some farmers sell it as a strong Merino, but it just sits in that sort of space between that super fine, super soft apparel wool,
mm-hmm.
And then those sort of easy spinning, stronger, more durable wools.
that are, you know, really, really chunky and great.
Yeah, so, that staple length is pretty long too, isn't it?
It's yes, 110 is quite long. Yeah, so that's over 12 months of growing, which is normal practice across mm-hmm. shearing.
Mm-hmm.
And it's sort of the maximum length that wool processors can handle.
Mm-hmm.
But what it means is that you have less ends per, you know, inch or whatever.
Less pilling.
Less pilling.
Right.
Ours does pill because we don't do a super wash treatment, and we have a quite an open spin. But it does, it leads to, you know, that is one of the outcomes is that it is less pilling. It's, with that stronger micron, it makes it a tiny bit more durable. So in regular commercial spinning world, Polwarth is a fibre that's sought after by the suit makers because you put it in the bum of a suit, it cops more wear and it holds up quite well. So that having that literal strength about the fibre is good in that sense.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I'm often unaware of the benefits of it, you know, because I'm always surrounded by it and that's the only thing I know. So I don't often compare and contrast, but I'm told that it's buttery, soft handle, and it is, people said it's a joy to knit with, and I don't know if that's just it's fun to actually work with it and then they enjoy wearing it afterwards, but they enjoy the knitting process. So it must feel okay while you're doing it.
Now, I'll ask you now, is it worsted spun or woolen spun? Do you know?
So ours is worsted.
Yeah.
We have done a little bit of woolen in the past, but we work with a worsted mill.
So the other sticky beaking that I've been doing on your website, you talk about grass to garment. Mm-hmm. Now, Nicole and I have come up with paddock to project.
Nice.
As well. So we would love to know about the actual production of the yarn once you get the wool.
Perfect. Yeah. So my brother grows the Polwarth wool over 12 months on the farm surrounding us. We're all part of the one farm, but he concentrates on growing that and making sure the soil is good, the health of the sheep is right, that the fibre length is good, the soundness of the wool is good. There's a lot that goes into, you know, before shearing.
Mm-hmm.
After shearing, which happens in February for us, we go through scouring to wash out all of the vegetable matter, lanolin wool grease, all the bits that get collected into the fibres over the year of growing. That happens in Geelong at a mill that we've been working with over the last 20 years or so. And Geelong's got an amazing heritage of wool processing that is not particularly visible these days, mm-hmm. But mm-hmm. it's lovely to be able to work with a 100-year-old firm that still processes wool in Geelong. From there, the bulk of our yarn, wool goes into yarn in Napier in New Zealand, where there's a great mill there that has the right sort of scale where they can have all of the good machines and the expertise. It's been set up by wool growers back in the day who recognised they needed to add some value to their product. And so that's where it's the reason for it was essentially wool growers enhancing their product. So yeah, it goes to New Zealand, and Design Spun do a great job in the steps from scoured through to dyed and balled, and then back to here. We do a little bit with top making as well, which we do in Bacchus Marsh with Cashmere Connections. And we've been experimenting a little bit over the time with some Australian spun stuff with Great Ocean Road Woolen Mill,
mm-hmm.
and a few others over the last 5 years. That there's a couple of mills that no longer exist, but prior to that we used to have all of our wool through to end product manufactured in Geelong, but those options have closed and the businesses have sold, the expertise has left and the equipment's been traded elsewhere.
You had mentioned before that the yarn is not super wash. Can you explain for our viewers what super washing is and then why you choose not to do that?
Yeah, sure. So super wash is a treatment of the wool, usually done, I think, in the scouring process, after the scouring process, which it strips off the scales that sit on the outside of a wool fibre. So if you were to take one fiber of wool, one little length, under the microscope, it'll look like a fish, where it's kind of covered in little scales.
Yep.
And the little scales that have a little like edge on them, like this, you know? And so it's those little edges that are what bind into each other in the felting process. And so to avoid that felting process, factories put the wool through a solution, which I'm not full bottle on what it is, but it's a chlorine, I think, based solution that strips off those little edges like that, and then it makes it smooth. And then I understand that then it's then a silicon type coating that goes over the top. And so that what that does do is it sort of puts a wrap around the fibers so that they're not going to rub on each other and felt. It enhances the softness of the fiber as well, because it's I don't understand why, but I do know that there's treatments that you can put onto wool that have the effect of reducing the micron by like two microns sort of thing, and it say what might be stronger wool that comes across as softer wool. That process isn't available to producers in Australia, nor in New Zealand, I understand. And I think that's, I understand this to be because of EPA regulations,
mm-hmm.
Which raises a few alarm bells.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The reason we don't do it is we think, I don't think we have to do that in order to sell our wool. I don't think we need to subject the wool to that process. There's enough people that understand what it means to be a fully natural product that we don't need to go down that path. If it helps to kind of educate people along the way to say that, you know, you have to run a depiller over it every now and then, you have to be a bit more careful with how you wash it, then, you know, that's a job I'm prepared to do. But we don't think that we need to do that.
Tom, can you tell our viewers what is the Australian Fibre Collective?
Yeah, sure. It's a really great program that helps confirm the origins and the supply chain of products that are 100% Australian made and manufactured. So what it is a group of people that ask anyone who's keen to sell something as such, that they supply all the evidence that says this is how this product is made and grown. So it's a really good and very rigorous and very authentic way to gauge that it is Australian grown and made.
Okay, we are now in the wool shop and somebody has let me loose with all this games, right? Look out. Tom, can you showcase some of these beautiful yarns?
Sure thing. Our Polwarth is spun into 4-ply and 8-ply. And so the 4-ply is a 2-strand construction. 8 is 4. There's no sense, there's no logic. 4 is 2 and 4 is 8. So hand-dyed these ones just by myself and my partner Jason, inspired by my mum who dyed stuff in a very erratic way in my childhood. So I kind of learnt a little bit from her, but mainly using landscape dyes, also Dharma dyes. And we've just got a little studio down the end here that we do that in. And we use our white, but also our natural grey as a base, which gives some of the darker sort of shades a bit more kind of heatheriness to it, so it's not just a flat colour.
Mm-hmm. I'm just going to pull them off here. So
that's our cream one in 4-ply. And
is this the other one?
Yeah, that's our taupe in 4-ply. So this is 8-ply. And
they'll take the dye differently?
It does, yeah. So it's... you can put a really bright colour over that and it will just sort of obviously dull it down, but it just gives you, because each sheep has different sort of colours in it, when you look at it with a bit more of a magnifying glass, you'll see that there's darker fibres as well as lighter ones. And so because dark and light in itself take up dye differently, then it's, you end up with quite a nice depth of colour through that yarn.
So it's almost like a natural variegation.
Yeah, totally, yeah. And even when we commercially dyed that one, we did three colours with that one. In the commercial one, where it's all like flat, even colour the whole way through,
mm-hmm.
it just had a lot more depth to the finished garment, I reckon.
And I think that makes, at least in garment knitting, for a more interesting garment.
Yeah, absolutely. I think so too. And our style is pretty fluid. We don't really work to too many recipes. So there's one left here and somebody's saying, can you please do more of that one? I was like, absolutely not. I'm so sorry. If it's not there, it don't exist and it won't. So
I think that happened to Nicole at the Australian Sheep and Wool Show last year.
Yeah, totally. Because the way that we do these ones is, you know, we're not smart enough to have a replicated sort of system in place here. That's why we've got our commercially dyed ones.
It also makes them, though, a bit more bespoke, doesn't it?
Absolutely, yeah.
So if you're looking for that kind of a rare skein, I reckon this is the place to come. How do you pick the colours?
Yeah.
Because you kind of have to be not only a business person in terms of setting up your supply chain and doing all of the business side of the production, but then you also have to have this.
I hope that it's like something that it evolves. I hope that it's that, because I think I've got no training. I mean, look, I'm wearing blue and beige. Like, I'm not a colour statement by any stretch. But
you've got a beautiful range.
But it seems to work okay. I think there's so many sources of inspiration out there. I mean, we have so much around us, but equally, like, it's really easy to use some of these dyes and putting them together once and going, that's horrendous. I'll remember that for next time. But equally, it's like, well, it's horrendous now, but I might just chuck another little bit of colour in it and see if it smartens up. So I don't know, maybe it's something that I'm developing, but certainly no theoretical or practical experience. But our stuff's fine. It's really great. Yeah.
No, it is. I'm knitting with it now, and you'll see that later. But this one has really caught my eye. How do you do that colour?
So that one's that natural grey base. So that's how it kind of helps to have a bit of something about it. And then I think I reckon I've probably just done a bit of low immersion dyeing with this one. The water doesn't cover the whole of the yarn. And so that way that you can kind of contain the dye in a certain area and it's not going to spread everywhere. And so you get deeper and lighter shades in the one skein.
It's absolutely beautiful. Yeah. So Tom, in addition to the commercial dye and the landscape dye that you use, are you using any natural dye techniques?
I would like to, yeah, absolutely. So we found the best way to do natural dyeing is not so much us doing it, but teaching people how to do it themselves. There's an incredible amount of extra hand time, rinsing time, etc. Mm-hmm. with natural dyes that makes it a tricky proposition. But by teaching people how to do it themselves, they get the joy of learning that skill, and it makes it perhaps a bit more sort of interesting for the people to do it themselves. We did a little dye workshop this morning here, and we did an indigo vat. We grow this one actually next to the stables. This is the Cineria, and this one was cherry ballart, which used to grow on the property here, mixed with indigo as well. So they don't have to be those super daggy 1970s browns and things.
Well, that's the thing with natural dyes. I have just started. To remember the name of the account, they have the most beautiful and vibrant colors, and so when you brought this out, I couldn't believe how just bright it was.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, it's a great it even gets darker, but it's nice to be able to grow the wool and also the dye on the one farm. So I think that's a kind of aspiration, is to be able to have something that's grown entirely here.
So in addition to all this beautiful yarn, what else is happening on the farm?
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity to talk about it. So we figure that everything's got to relate to a ball of wool. That's our core kind of reason to be here. But it means that we can invite wool crafters to come and stay on the farm and see, you know, what does it look like? And then we can talk to people with a little bit more time on our hands about what we do with our wool. So we've got accommodation in a couple of different places here for, and we try and encourage it as a woolcrafters' sort of place to stay. There's lots of other good reasons to be here, like there's a super fancy, amazing restaurant down the road, which people enjoy coming to as well. But we hope that this is a place that all people can come to. And then also having classes in various types of woolcraft. So it was natural dyeing this morning, but you know, there's crochet and weaving and spinning and stuff on the calendar at the moment, I think. We have an open sort of studio once a month, Crafty Sundays, and really that's about checking with our sort of local community, sort of from Port Ferry through to Ballarat to Apollo Bay and Geelong. That sort of we call our community because that's not too far to travel, and we just say, hey, come along for some lunch, bring whatever project you're working on, there's no charge. And it's a great way for us to see what people are making and how they respond to our products, what they want to see come up, but also just to give them an outlet, because sometimes it's a bit, you know, on your own, it's a bit quiet doing your woolcraft.
Crafting can be a very hobby.
Yeah, that's right. So Sunday afternoons is a great time to come out and hang here. So my firm belief is that this place is built for people. It's also built for sheep, but for people, and so by making it available to people to use is kind of what keeps me excited.
And how can people find out more?
Look, we're on all the sort of social medias and that sort of stuff. Tarndwarncoort, I haven't given you an explanation of what that word is, because it's a brand that is on our label, and most people are like, I'm not even going to attempt to say that. But it's almost like a little challenge to say, hey, there's an amazing history of this place, even before my ancestors were here in 1840. And Tarndwarncoort is a Gulidjan word, and it refers to the landscape where we are here. And one version, one telling of the story is that it means up and down like a bandicoot running. I don't know how sort of accurate that is as a story, but you know, that's oral history. Does refer to the fact that there were bandicoots in the area. And that it was an important place for Gulidjan people. And in fact, the building that we're standing in now was one of the purposes of it, was to, as a rendezvous point for the Gulidjan people, that sort of transition into the colonial period started. Mm-hmm. Then this was a place for welfare rations. My great-great-grandfather was heavily involved in the church and also in looking after Aboriginal people. So, long explanation about what is Tarndwarncoort. It's a challenge for people to go, okay, there's an Aboriginal word, we're going to try and muster some tongue dexterity.
Mm-hmm.
However, we always refer to the place as Tarndie because we're in Australia. When it's too hard, we whack a vowel at the end,
mm-hmm.
and job's done. So that's our website, tarndie.com.
Fantastic. Tom, thanks so much for the for your time today. We really appreciate it.
Hey, thanks to you for giving us a chance to talk to people about it, and for people tuning in. It's, these guys are doing a super job, and I hope you enjoy all of the stuff coming up. You're in very safe hands. These guys are good researchers.
Thank you.
Thank you.
How fun was that? I had so much fun talking to Tom, and we learned so much.
Yeah, he's super fun and really just humbly knowledgeable. I don't think he has any real perspective on just the depth of his knowledge about the Australian farming industry and yarn production. I guess it's one of those things that just really kind of seeps into your blood when you've grown up with it and you're the sixth generation.
I know, there's such a rich history here.
Yeah,
And just feels really special that we're able to actually stay here.
Yeah, and they're lovely. There's a real a really lovely connection to where they've come from as well. I was pleased to hear that there was some positive stories about working and supporting local Indigenous people, even back in history when within Australian history, there's a lot of very negative stories about that. And I just, I really, he just has this deep passion for what he does.
And that really comes through.
Yeah.
And I think that also flows through to the yarn that they produce.
Yeah.
So
certainly even when you meet him at yarn shows, he's, because that's how he sort of got the idea to come out here. I met him at Bendigo last year and I was looking for particular colours and he was just so helpful. So if you can get to Tarndie, which is about 2 hours drive from Melbourne, it's well worth the visit.
Mm. Could make it part of a day trip, really.
Yeah, absolutely. Yep, for sure. So we have some Tarndie themed tips to talk about today.
Absolutely.
I might kick off with, this is a little project that I've been working on. It's a toddler blanket for a dear little girl who I've never met. She lives in New York City. So this is the painting honeycombs. I always want to say painting bricks, but painting honeycombs blanket. We're just picking dog hair off it. Painting honeycombs blanket by Stephen West. And I've started this project quite a while ago. As I said, this little one is not a baby anymore. She's now almost three, but she was born during the pandemic and I was working constantly in the hospital at that stage and had absolutely no bandwidth for any sort of fun project. But my partner's going over for a visit soon, so I thought I better send some little loving gift her way. So very excited to see what she thinks of this lovely blanket, using primarily Tarndie yarn. So the main colour here that I've used is, this is from the Tarndie commercially dyed range, so very, very regular in colour. And this is the Lime Mortar DK yarn. So it's this lovely sort of kind of cool grey, whitish grey colour.
Yeah.
And then for the other yarns, I've got a bit of a mixed bag because really I just wanted to bring lots of vibrant colour to it. So I've got some Cleckheaton Country in a really rich purple, some Heirloom Merino Magic. So these are all Australian yarns, a mixture of some more commercially available brands and some more unique stuff like the Tarndie. Very hard to get that other than at Tarndie or at wool shows. Some Heirloom Merino Magic, and then always or often coming back to Bendigo Woollen Mills as well. So you might recognize this color as being from my Real Easy Raglan that we featured in the last episode. And then I've also got this other bamboo wool blend, which is it's called the Galaxy colorway, and again it's a discontinued colorway. I do lots of, with Bendigo Woolen Mills you get 200 gram balls, so if you end up with yarn left over from a project, it's a great big chunky stash dive.
I love the color flex in that.
Yeah, it's super fun. And it does just give a lovely little highlight to the blanket. And this is, look, baby blankets, any blankets. They're such big projects.
It's a lot of knitting. It's a lot of knitting.
I mean, we've talked about this. You always think it's going to be a lovely,
it'll knit up quick.
Yeah.
Don't worry about it. It's kind of, it's
DK.
The last one I did was bulky.
Oh, simple pattern. They take so long. You just hope that they're really loved at the end.
Oh, it was
so
cool. It's just beautiful.
I think this one with its rainbow colours, I mean, I love it. So hopefully this little one does. And both her parents are Australian and her mum in particular is very, very, very passionate that she keeps her Australian accent. So I've made sure that all the yarn that I used was Australian as a little gift from a home that she's never known, but might come back to one day.
It's so thoughtful.
Mm. So what have you got on your needles?
Mm. I have had this yarn in my stash, I think, since 2019. And when I knew that we were coming to Tarndie, I was like, that's it. I'm gonna make something with it. And I wanted to make a sweater for my husband, but unfortunately I didn't have enough meterage. Who knew? Anyway, but then I got to make myself a shawl, another one. How about it?
You can never have too many shawls.
Here we go. This is the I think it's called Highwraith shawl by Claire, Claire Walls. I thought it was Wallace, but it's not, it's Walls. And this is what it looks like. The yarn is the Tarndie natural colorway. So this is an undyed Polwarth, and it's just a beautiful taupey brown gray. And I just love how that's knitting up. It's gonna be beautiful as a winter shawl. The pattern was originally published in Lina. We still haven't figured out how to pronounce that. Anyway, there are 52 weeks of shawls, but I checked Ravelry today and it's also available as a single pattern. And it is a really fun knit. So it starts at the longest part and then every other row you decrease. So it gets shorter with each time, which as opposed to the last project I did, which just got longer. This has been a really good palette cleanse knit for me.
So if you watched episode 3, Gayan did the Mortar Noah shawl, which had a lot, 600 and something stitches at its widest point. So, you know, the excitement as you get to the end of a project and yet each row takes you...
It was about an hour.
An hour, yeah.
Not so with this project. So I'm loving that about the construction. So I can really highly recommend this pattern too. It's also really well written. There's a little chart that is, it's the first time I've done charts and let's see, I've probably been knitting this for about 2 weeks, three weeks.
You've made some progress.
I have, yep. I have. Because again, I just started back at work recently, so.
And I have to say, the yarn, it was interesting when we were talking to Tom, he was like, you know, this is the only yarn or the only wool I've ever worked with. I don't really know whether, like, we like it and it's great because it's got a story, but I don't really know what it's like to work with. And he's not really a knitter himself, but the yarn is super spongy and bouncy and actually a real joy to work with.
Absolutely. And I cannot wait to block it. Because I think it's, I just think it's going to be incredible.
And it's a bit coarser because of the Lincoln sheep in there than superfine merino, but it is still like next to skin soft, at least for me. And I actually have pretty sensitive skin, so.
Yeah, no, I think I'll have no problem wearing this around my neck, as a shawl. Beautiful. And I am addicted to these little rows, these little lace patterns. And it's an easy pattern.
Yeah. It's looking really beautiful.
Thank you.
I also have a quirky little project. So I first came to visit Tarndie maybe 6 months ago. When I was in the area with my partner, and I had just been reading about assigned pooling. And
remember, we talked with Emily about some assigned pooling.
Yeah. So, very briefly, Dawn Barker in the US, started working on these patterns. She's now just known as Dawn Barker on Ravelry and, Barker Wool on her website. But she had started working on these patterns where you actually highlight the pooled colours in yarn. And there's a number of different patterns available. And I really wanted to give it a go. I kind of got a bit obsessed with it and then couldn't find any yarn locally, and then was going to order some, but the particular dyer that I was going to use didn't have anything available at the time. And anyway, I happened to stumble into the farm shop and saw some yarn that I thought might be suitable. And I was talking to Tom about it and he'd never heard of it. So we ended up down a bit of a rabbit hole on Ravelry around assigned pooling patterns and what they meant and so on and so forth. And a cute little story is today, during the dyeing workshop, because he knew I was coming, I had told him that assigned pooling, I think I'd read it or I'd heard it somewhere, that normally about 14 inches of dyed yarn was the right amount for assigned pooling. And he remembered it as 13 centimeters. So he had this little sample. He's like, look what I did. And I was, that's lovely. A different kind
you
of
could probably do a little bit.
It would be
smaller.
It would be a delicious little a little fleck through thing. So actually, it was still super cute yarn. But this is I just wanted to give it a go. When I went into the store, there were only two skeins left. As he mentioned in the interview, everything's pretty small batches. He doesn't sort of do any a lot of replicable dyeing,
no recipes.
Yeah. So this is, it looks like maybe that natural, well, I think it is that natural grey base with a vibrant grassy green and then perhaps even some bleached areas in here as well. So there's some very pale white yarn in here. And it was roughly, I got two skeins. One was roughly 14 inches. One was a little bit less, I think. And I thought I'd just give them a go. So I found a two skein project, which is actually a free pattern. And it's called The Popping Yarn Dictatorship. It's done by Claire Cameron. And it's quite a fun, quirky little sort of scarf that starts at a point. Gets wider in the middle when you've only got two skeins and you're not quite, like if you have a slightly different quantity than the pattern, it does mean that you can kind of go, all right, well, when I get to the middle, I'm going to start reducing again. So it starts at a point, it will end at a point, and pop stands for pulling on purpose. So that's where the name came from.
That makes perfect sense now.
Absolutely, yeah. And so when you look at Dawn Barker, she does have lots of different YouTube tutorials on different cluster stitches, and her patterns contain a number of them. But this particular one uses a floret cluster stitch, which with this yarn, with our Australian background, to me, I just can't get over the resemblance to gum nuts and like gum nut trees, which are everywhere in Australia. So I'm calling it my gum nut scarf, and it's super fun. It's super fun. It's quirky,
really,
but it's super fun.
Yeah.
Yep. And it's quite creative as you go. It's quite ad hoc. The idea is that when you get to the colourful part of yarn, you do a floret stitch. But sometimes you'll end up on the colourful part where you've just done a floret and you don't necessarily want to do another one so fast, so close, so you do it again. And one of the other things I've learned about these kind of pulling on purpose stitches is it does help to have some change in size, so they're often sort of on the diagonal. Otherwise, with the way the yarn is, you'll kind of just end up with this row of, so this has increases and decreases every four rows, so to give you that.
So they won't line up.
Yeah. So today when we came to Tarndie, I couldn't help but pick up a third skein. As I was doing my gum nut and seeing the gum nuts emerge from the floret stitches, I just kept thinking of gum nut trees, which often have really pretty sort of daffodil yellow or kind of really earthy pink kind of blooms on them. So I've picked up this lovely, I don't know what colour we would call this. It's quite an earthy sort of...
It does. It's earthy, kind of pink. It's a bit Australian red sand.
Yeah. Color,
but paler. It's not as...
I suspect fresh. It's dyed on the natural coloured yarn again.
One with, like this.
Yeah. So my plan is to do, and I haven't worked out what I'm going to do, so if you've got some ideas of some lovely little borders, please pop them in the chat, pop them in the comments. But I'm intending to do a little pink border of this just to bring out the colour. And the pattern just uses, it doesn't have an I-cord edge or anything. So maybe if I was doing it again, I might create my own I-cord edge.
You could actually I-cord all the way around it with the red.
Well, that's what I'm thinking. Yeah, I just wanted a bit more of a tidier kind of edge on it. It does have some lovely little sort of yarn over holes in the edge, which does give a nice little bit of detail there. Which of course I'll leave, but yeah, something, just an extra layer I'm thinking on top of that, just to give it a little bit of a colour pop there.
Mm-hmm. Well, my acquisition is kind of a good news, bad news story. When we visited Colac probably a year ago, I went to the local yarn shop that was called March Yarns. And at March Yarns, I purchased this skein of Poema Tweed by Lane du Nord. And this is a sport weight, which has a color gradient that I thought was beautiful. It goes from a kind of a charcoal gray to a steel blue, almost teal kind of color. And I thought because we were coming back to the area, I would go back to March Yarns and pick up a coordinating skein to go with it, but unfortunately they've closed. So that was a bit sad.
Yeah.
But that actually meant that I had like an actual purpose to get some yarn at Tarndie. Like I really needed one, but I have quite a bit of yarn in my stash, so I wanted to have an actual project that I could hold myself accountable to start and allocate the yarn to. So I bought a few skeins of their 8-ply in this beautiful red color that I think will match wonderfully with this gradient. And my intention is to make a cinnabar shawl by Andrea Mowry, and I think this is going to be a delight.
It's a gorgeous combination of colours.
To knit with, and another beautiful shawl.
Yep. Yep. And we really can't get enough of this Polwarth yarn. And this is from the hand-dyed range, so it just has an item number.
Oh, that's right. It doesn't have an actual colour.
Yeah. So, yes. It'll be a bit of a one-off as well.
Yeah. No, it's a beautiful wine colour. And I think they have a limited range on their website.
But they tend, I think they just number them in order of dyeing rather than do, as I said before, replicable recipes.
No recipes.
We also wanted to talk about the needles that I'm using. I mean, coincidentally, I'm using them for the what we're calling the gumnut scarf, but we don't just twin in clothing and project bags. We twin in needle purchases as well. So these are the Leica, which I think is how you pronounce it, Cypra. So they're copper needles. And
I saw them and I just thought they were beautiful and immediately was like, I need these needles in my life.
And as we've mentioned previously, we do try and find companies with tools and with yarn that have ethical
socially responsible.
Socially responsible practices. And we're quite confident with these needles that that there's a reasonable level of transparency. So that was part of the decision for buying them, but they are beautiful. But they're quite different needles to knit with. I thought that they would be like a metal needle.
I figured they would be slick as just your standard, what are they, nickel?
No. Stainless steel?
Yeah,
stainless steel. They're very different. So for me, they're almost like knitting with somewhere between a bamboo and a steel needle, mm-hmm. Or a metal needle, in terms of the grippiness. They sort of do grip the yarn a little bit more than you do normally get with metal needles. And the other thing is, as you can see, they tarnish because they're copper. So you can purchase a cleaning cloth.
Mm-hmm.
I think we both decided just to let them do their thing. They do, as you're like, I have paused this project for a while, so my needles are currently quite tarnished, but you've noticed.
I did the same, when I was knitting Martinoa. I put that project on hibernation, but when I came back to it, and started knitting again, the needles, I guess probably the top third of the needle, or maybe the top half of the needle, became shiny again.
So I think they do sort of respond to, obviously the tarnishing in the way that copper usually tarnishes, but I think they do also maybe respond to some of the oils in the wool.
Possibly.
Theoretically, fingers should make them tarnish.
I think the takeaway from that, right, is to just keep knitting.
Yeah, just keep knitting with them.
Spend more time with
them. As I say, you can get cleaning cloths. I don't mind the natural look of them, but you can see in my set that there are some very beautiful shiny needles that have never been used, and any that I have used, so that have had fingers touching them, do end up a bit more tarnished. So you do get a bit of a variegated appearance to your needles. But the other beautiful thing about these Leica needles is they have nice twisty ends on the interchangeable circulars. What is the technical term? They're not called twisty ends. Let's keep coining a new term. Twisty ends. So they don't twist. They twist within the needle. They don't twist up in your project, which is very enjoyable to work with. I think it might be time for our pairing of the show. And because we're on a little mini break, a little overnight away, we have some bubbles because why not? So the bubbles that we've got today, it's Brown Brothers Prosecco, but it's their premium brut non-vintage Prosecco. So Prosecco often has a little bit of sort of sweetness to it. It's a lighter, fruitier kind of bubbly style. This one's a little bit drier, so it's a little bit more savoury, a little bit drier. It's actually probably one of my favourite Proseccos on the Australian market. Prosecco is a bit of a controversial topic because the name Prosecco, the same way as champagne is protected, the name Prosecco is currently going through a process of protection. And in fact, it is actually a protected denomination name in everywhere apart from Australia. And that's a bit of a quirky story. Because back when the first Prosecco vines were brought into Australia, or the first real Prosecco industry took off, which is in the King Valley, which is where this wine is from, and very much led by, at the time, a lot of passion from the local Italian families there, they were imported as Prosecco cuttings. as Prosecco vines, not named after the grape variety, which is Glera, because often in Italy, the name becomes, well, and in this case, the name, people called them Prosecco grapes, even though that wasn't technically their name. So when Australia imported Prosecco grape variety, it was just called Prosecco. And in Australia, we often label our wines. We don't have any appellations here. We just label them varietally. Mm-hmm. So we were just putting the grape on the label. So I think that's back in the international courts. We'll see what happens. There's a bit of a conjecture about that. But this particular wine, I chose it for today because it is Victorian. It's made by Brown Brothers, which is one of Australia's first families of wine. So I can't remember the exact year that their heritage goes back to, but it's like the mid 1850s, which is very early in Australian wine history. And they are based up in Milawa, which is where their initial vineyards were, but they do a lot of growing in the King Valley, which is an excellent, very cool climate, high altitude region for grapes like Prosecco and Pinot Grigio, and there's a lot of Italian varietals there. Mm. Have you been to the King Valley?
Indeed, we went for our anniversary 1 year, and we went and had lunch at Brown Brothers. They're beautiful.
The restaurant there is gorgeous. Yeah, absolutely. The other lovely thing about the Brown family is that, so around the King Valley area, it was an area where there was a lot of tobacco production up until sort of the 70s. So a lot of Italian families that came over were encouraged into farming, in tobacco farming around the King Valley region. And when the tobacco industry moved offshore, and this was also around the time when there was increased health warnings around smoking and that type of thing, there were a lot of families that were looking for something to do with their land.
Oh, yeah.
And the Brown family had been producing grapes and wine for, I guess over 100 years at that stage. So this is sort of the mid-1970s, early 1980s. And they actually reached out to a lot of these families and said, well, why don't you grow grapes for us? So they all sort of switched over to viticulture, and now a lot of those families have gone on and created their own family brands. So names like Pizzini and Dalzotto and Chrismont and San Miranda. So yeah, lots of families that have started out in grape growing through that connection. So I'm going to run you through how to taste a sparkling wine, because it's a little bit different. Now, the first thing you'll notice is this is in a normal glass, not in a flute. Flutes actually, they help the bubbles look beautiful, but they reduce your ability to really smell and taste a wine properly. So it's a bit of a wine wanker thing, but I always like to drink bubbles out of normal glasses because you taste them a bit better than out of a flute.
I feel like I have more in here than I would in a flute as well, which is...
You actually don't. You actually don't. There's not much in there at all.
Okay.
Yeah. So, but that's good. The illusion of more is great. So with sparkling wine, when you're normally tasting wine, you see people swirling it to try and get more air into it. With sparkling wine, the first sip you have, you don't really want to swirl it because you'll knock the bubbles out. So usually if you're tasting at any sort of serious competition level, you'll taste it, you'll smell it and taste it, and then you want to knock the bubbles out because it helps you taste it better. We're not going to do that today because we want to enjoy this glass of wine when we stop filming. But in a wine exam, it's quite shocking. You'll see people pop their hand over the top of the glass and shake the whole thing. You make sure you're wearing dark trousers that day, but shake the whole thing to really knock the bubbles out because the bubbles do mask some of the aromas.
Ah.
It's a quirky.
I had never knew that.
Yeah, it's a very different world.
But I'm gonna try this and tell you what I think I taste.
Go for it.
Okay.
Yep.
So when I initially smell that wine, I smell persimmons, those orange fruits. And then I taste quite a bit of lemon, mm-hmm. or like, I guess, tart citrus. And I also taste like buttered toast.
Okay. That last one is an interesting note. So I love the persimmon note because I think that's really, really good. And it's not something that jumps to your mind when you work in wine, is that you're going to get the persimmon character from Prosecco. But I think you do. And that's one of the really beautiful things about tasting wine. There's actually no wrong answers, really. There's probably logical explanations between just about everything. And it's actually really lovely, as someone who's worked in wine for a long time, to taste wine with people who don't, because you'll find that people who work in wine come up with quite similar tasting notes, whereas people who don't think a bit more broadly, and that's actually a really gorgeous thing. Yeah, look, I think your note was really good. Lots of lemon, lots of grapefruit. As I said, this is quite dry, so it's got, we talked a little bit about texture and the way it feels in your mouth. There's a little bit of like a grapefruit pithy kind of texture in this Prosecco as well. Glera or Prosecco is a grape variety that doesn't usually spend time on lees in bottle in the same way champagne does. So when I say lees, it's dead yeast cells, and it's a really important part of the champagne aging process. And we might do a little mini tutorial on that in another episode. This is probably not spending a lot of time on those yeast cells, but it is the yeast cells that do give a toastiness to it. So I wonder if it's just maybe because it's a non-vintage product, maybe there would be wine of different ages in there. There might be a little bit more sort of nuttiness of aged wine that you're picking up as that sort of toasty kind of character. But it's delicious, very dry. We're going to pair it with some shawl and blanket knitting this afternoon, mm-hmm. and a big bowl of nachos as well. So
coming right up.
Thank you very much for joining us today. We hope you have enjoyed the episode.
We really enjoy bringing you so much about Victoria.
And it's just lovely getting out and meeting all these fantastic people that are contributing to the Australian fibre industry and offering so many beautiful options to make our knitting practice that little bit much more special and more enjoyable. So please, as we said at the beginning, if you've enjoyed this episode, give us a little thumbs up, subscribe to our channel, and share with your friends, and
don't forget to comment like how Nicole should finish the edging of her shawl.
Oh yes, I need help with that. Also, if you've got any wine questions, pop them in the comments as well.
Mm-hmm. And if you have any other makers that you think we should be highlighting,
absolutely,
people that we might not know about,
very open to all ideas. So thank you, lovely ones. Have a lovely day, evening, wherever you are. We're going to go into the evening here, and we'll see you next time.
Happy knitting!